Praise the Lord, saints, and welcome back to FFT, Food for Thought Ministries, where we move with purpose and our walk with Christ over here. My name is RoceeshaMuhammad Muhammad, and welcome to my channel. This is the part two to the Bible review of the Perry Stone Hebraic Prophetic New Testament Study Bible. If you haven't already, go check out the Old Testament. I already have that posted up. I wanted to break it up into two parts. Amen. And this is in the King James Version. I'm just going to read the back like I did on the first one, and then we're going to jump on in into the New Testament. Amen. And it basically says the same exact thing. It says, deriving from more than 40 years worth of biblical study and deep desire to help others unlock the mysteries of the scripture, Perry Stone, which is a popular preacher and teacher, has produced the Hebraic Prophetic New Testament Study Bible. These pages contain the New Testament scriptures from the King James Version, along with insightful commentary and historical context, offering readers a deep knowledge of the Word of God. And who doesn't want to dig deeper into the Word? Amen. I haven't seen again this Bible being reviewed on YouTube at all anywhere. Amen. So I thought I'd just bring it to the surface so people may want to be able to dig deeper into the Word of God using the commentary of Perry Stone. Amen. So it says this Bible includes the complete New Testament in the King James Version, commentary on nearly every verse of the New Testament, in-depth articles about each book of the Bible, and notes appended to the biblical text at relevant points, offering more detailed information and context. Amen. So here we have, again, the Perry Stone Hebraic Prophetic New Testament Study Bible. And here it is. I have the set, Old and New Testament. Let's get it out of this box. Put that over here. All right. So it's thin. It's almost like a thin line, New Testament. Amen. So we have here New Testament only. The Perry Stone Hebraic Prophetic Study Bible, and it is in the KJV. There's tool lines here, gold stamping, nothing fancy, just flat surface. This is like a marbly brownish color, leather touch. It's not real leather. There's no gilding, as you can see. It's just white all the way around, and there is brown and white head and tail bands. Okay, and you see here no gilding at all, just plain white, and again brown and white head and tail bands. All right, same on the back, nothing special. All right, so let's get into this, you guys. Again, like a paper paste down. I don't know what this material is, but it's the same as the first one. You have your presentation page, you have your notes in the beginning. Okay, then you have the Perry Stone Hebraic Prophetic Study Bible, New Testament, King James Version, commentary written by Perry Stone. I hope that's in the book. Perry Stone, all right. Okay, and we have here, this was copyrighted in 2016, and this was also printed in the United States, all right. And this is the first edition. And I believe that he's not printing these out anymore. Once they're sold out, he's done. He's not gonna reprint them. So I think it's kind of like a limited type of edition. That's why I wanted to just grab it, just to have it in my library, amen, of Bibles of different study. And the only thing that's really special about this to me is that the commentary of each scripture, or almost every scripture, is embedded in the study notes, so you wouldn't have to get a separate commentary book. But I do got a commentary video coming, because I did get me a couple of commentary books. But anyway, all New Testament from Matthew to Revelations. Amen. From Matthew to Revelations. I hope I'm in here. Table of contents. And you have, again, a letter from Perry Stone. Introduction into the history of the Bible. All right. Selecting the books in the Bible, the numerous different types of translations. These is the people, I guess, that helped do the commentary with him. And then we get into New Testament. Amen. And boom, here we are, Matthew. And just like in the other, in the Old Testament, we have, this is the book introduction here, Matthew. This middle section is the biblical text. It is two columns. And down here in this section right here would be the commentary study notes. Amen. We do see the articles here. The five women in the genealogy of Christ is given here. Just a little bit more. You can see the scriptures here and the study notes down here. Same, pretty much the same setup. Amen. Articles, the power of temptation. Did Satan add to the scriptures? Wow. Okay, it's going to be some interesting thing. I know I'm going to be digging deep into New Testament next year, so I can't wait. I got so many things going on and ready, right? The message and meaning of repent. Wow. Okay. The difference between the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God. That's something different and good to know. A breakdown of how Christ fulfilled the law. If you had any questions about that, he'll give you his interpretation or commentary on that. The Lord's Prayer, broken down right here. Okay. What is trespass? We say, forgive us for our trespass, right? Mm-hmm. Let the dead bury the dead. Man, okay, let's see. This passage seemed to imply that Christ was rebuking a young man for desiring to bury his father, which sounds rather cold and uncaring among the Jews in Christ's day. The dead were buried on the day of their death before sunset. The body was wrapped in linen and placed in a large niche in a limestone tomb, similar to a cave. After 1 year, the family returned to the tomb to unwind the linen around the bones. Wow. They washed the bones in water and rubbed them with oil. What? Afterward, placing them in a stone box called an ossuary. In this instance, the young man was asking Christ's permission to return to the tomb and perform this ritual. Christ told him to let those who had no spiritual calling perform this task, while the young man followed him. Oh, gotcha. Okay, that's good to know. So what is this here? This is saying Matthew 8 and Mark 5. Jesus came to the other side of the sea. Jesus came to the other side of the sea. So you have those in comparable. They're telling the same story. So that's to be expected to have overlapping texts. That's why you say let the text, scripture interpret scripture. Amen. This is where we should be at, up in here in this New Testament. All right. What is binding and loosing? Ooh. Okay. That should be good. That should be real good. We need to know about that. Okay. Let's see. This is just Matthew. There's no red letter at all, as you can see. We already in Matthew and there is none. Hiding the Lord's money. That's interesting. Oh. Y'all see this? Where did Jesus' body go? Matthew in depth, when Christ was born, the time of John's Baptist. So you get all this in-depth view of Matthew. Then you go into Mark. All right, let's find something. Let me see. John. Oh, let's hit up Romans. Yeah, Romans. I love the book of Romans, y'all. I love the book of Romans. Let's see what it's talking about. Believers' access to God. Okay. What shall we say then? This is Romans 6 and 1. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? So this is basically saying, if you've been free from sin, how can you continue to be in it? How can you continue to sin if you've been, if you out of it? If you ain't living it, if you dead to sin, how you continue to live in it, right? Wow. Because we keep on saying, well, gotta forgive me, gotta forgive me. But why would you want to continue in it if you dead to it? Duh. I don't know. Anyway. Okay. It pays to serve the devil. Whoa. What? Look at that. The law cannot defeat sin. Y'all see, I'm looking at this for the first time too, so y'all forgive me. Just give me a second. Y'all just browse, okay? Y'all know how I do. I just wanted to read something real quick. Oh, where did it go? Okay. Wow. Okay, my bad, y'all. I'm just looking. I was just reading something. Sorry, y'all. Sorry. Apologies. Okay. Coming behind and no gift. Let me find Ephesians. That's where I want to be at. Galatians is good too. Ooh, I really like the book of Galatians too, y'all. Let me find Ephesians though. I want to look at something real quick. Oh, Philippians. Oh, I go Ephesians. Okay, let's see here now. Ephesians 6. I just want to look at some spiritual warfare stuff, see what you got to say. If you got anything for, if you got anything on the spiritual warfare, because that's what I'm, boom, understanding the power of the armor of God, okay? That's what I'm talking about, because this is what it's all about, this war. Come on, somebody. Come on now. You got all these Greek stuff up in here. Okay. A soldier would use the lion belt to attach his sword and a small shield to him. The belt also held together parts of the armor in place and was used to tie or bind up the garment, called grinding up the loins, so the soldier would not trip when going to battle. The belt also displayed awards and medals for heroism in battle. This first piece of equipment, truth, holds all things together. So the belt of truth holds all things together. The breastplate is called the Greek, whatever that is, which can literally mean a heart protector. So we have to put our breastplate on because it's going to protect our heart. Amen. The soldier's breastplate was made from strips of metal connected together, but it was created to be flexible to allow the soldier mobility in battle. The breastplate was designed to protect the vital organs of the soldier's body. The purpose of the metal was to deflect the blows from the enemy swords and other weapons, protecting especially the heart. All right, righteousness is the quality of being right or just in God's eyes and doing things God's way. I say that all the time. Righteousness is just doing things right, doing things God's way. God's way of doing things is righteousness. Amen. Righteousness is imparted to the heart and spirit. You got to have your heart right in order to want to be right. Come on. And must be protected from the lies and the deception of the enemy. That's why you got to pray that breastplate on so you don't get deceived in the heart. The Roman soldier breastplate was made up of small metal plates tied together in a fashion similar to the way roof tiles are placed on a roof. It was placed over the soldiers and to protect both the soldiers front and back. Okay, the bottom of the breastplate was tied to the belt. Notice that righteousness, come on, must be tied to truth. Come on, because there is no righteousness unless we receive the word of God, which is the word of truth. I have often heard that the back was the only area without protection on the Roman's breastplate. After research, I have learned that this is incorrect. Thin metal sheets tied together with leather straps also formed a protection of the ribs around the back of the rib cage. These individuals and layered metals stripped gave a soldier freedom of movement in times of battle. Being righteous does not mean to be rigid, self-righteous, or legalistic, but it means to abide in God's love and keep our hearts pure through his righteousness. The soldiers' shoes were important. They were actually sandals made of leather with straps that wrapped around the calves up to the knees. The open-air design and soft leather of the shoe enabled the soldier to walk up to 25 miles a day without blisters and without developing fungi. A strip as metal was built into each shoe to provide more stability. Under both shoes were metal studs of two sizes, providing traction for walking, running, and standing for long hours when fighting. These spikes were excellent when standing on the heels or when trying to walk and the ground was slippery, because the spikes dug into the ground, assisting the soldier in his ability to move or stand. Part of the armor also included metal greaves that covered the ankle and the knees, thus protecting the shin and the knees. Believers are to be prepared to take the gospel of peace to all the people under all circumstances, and not to be knocked off their feet by the opposition we may encounter. Come on now. I ain't gonna keep reading that because I'm acting like I forgot I'm doing a review. Sorry, y'all. My apologies. I just get caught up. The meaning of sincere. When every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess. Look at this. Philippians. Oh, yeah, that's what I wanted to see. Is it 3? Or is it 4:13? I'm looking for 4:13. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Amen. Now standing ye have well done, and ye did communicate with my affliction. Come on now, somebody. This is going to be good. Let's see what it say down here. Another description of Paul's many trials is listed in 2 Corinthians, but in all things approving ourselves as the mysteries, ministers of God, and much patience in affliction, in necessities, in desireness, in distresses, my bad, in stripes, in imprisonments, in tumults. Give me one second, y'all. My thing about to stop here. I need to make sure. Give me one second. All right. In labor and watches and fasting, he learns that his strength came through Christ, and that in Christ's strength he could do all things. All right. Keys to supplying all your needs. Thessalonians. Seven keys to Christian living. And you got your in-depths on that. Several pages. The breakdown. Let's go to 2 Timothy. Okay, y'all see this? How to treat a widow. When F is a passing grade. Wow. Paul gives Timothy three final instructions, three words, all beginning with the letter F. Paul writes to flee, follow, and fight. Come on now. Paul tells Timothy to flee the love of money and other vices related to greed, pride, and strife. He also instructs Timothy to flee youthful lust. The Greek word for the flee is whatever that is, and means to run as fast as possible to escape danger. After fleeing, you must follow. And in this case, Timothy is to follow or pursue six spiritual manifestations: righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, and meekness, which is humbleness. Timothy is to lay hold on eternal life, like we all should, okay? To lay hold means to seize upon or seize upon it, as to reach out by force and to take something to yourself. That means to grab it and pull it near. Amen. As to reach out by force and take something to yourself. The force of this phrase, lay hold of, is preceded by the command to fight the good fight of faith. Come on. This fight is the constant battle to seize and hold on to the blessings of God, meaning you need to grab that thing and keep pulling the blessings of God to you, pulling the blessings of God to you consistently. That's the fight, that's the battle, because guess who's trying to take it? Guess who's trying to steal it? Okay, the devil. He trying to steal your peace, he trying to steal your blessing. So you got to take hold of God's blessing and continue to pull him to you. That is the battle in itself. Not only is he trying to take your blessings, he's trying to take your soul, he's trying to take your life, he's trying to take your peace, he's trying to take your happiness, your joy, your righteousness. He's trying to take everything. So we got to fight for that. You got to fight for that. Amen. My Lord, don't get me. Ooh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Qualifications of an ordained leader. All right, look at that. Whew, hallelujah. All right. Church is in the home of believers. Hebrews. I hope this is in here. I hope y'all getting this, because I can't even see. The Hall of Faith, Enoch is translated, and again, we got double column, and then we got the biblical, the commentary notes at the bottom. Then we get this, Christ's blood and heavenly sanctuary, James, another book of James. We know that was Jesus's brother, right? James is Jesus' brother. The power of the tongue. Wow. Look at that. A lot of people don't even be tripping on the power of the tongue, and it's a principle. God said we're going to eat the fruit thereof. You better speak life and don't speak death, because you're going to have what you say, good or bad. It's a principle. Principle goes good or bad. Always say the Lord willing. Wow, that's deep. That's true, because that's true. The days of our lives are set by the Lord. Come on. Who has them numbered? Since we are uncertain what a day may bring, our personal plans can suddenly be interrupted. Disrupting events that were arranged months earlier, causing personal disappointment. James taught that when we announce our plans, we should say, if the Lord wills. Come on. My father uses this phrase continuously when he would share his intentions to travel or break the daily routine. We should say, brother, I'll be there, the Lord willing. If we confess confidence that our footsteps are being ordered by the Lord and conclude our plans with, if the Lord is willing, any change or disruption will not be as disappointing. Come on, that's a good, woo, hallelujah. Then we can say God knows all things and there is a reason this did not work out, my Lord. So now I'm gonna have to start saying it because I wasn't saying that. Amen, God willing, I'll see y'all next week, right? And if I don't, you know God had other plans, hallelujah. Come on, somebody. A final outpouring of the Holy Spirit. That was good. That was good. I mean, I've heard that before. I just don't put it into practice. But I will start putting that into practice. Amen. All right, let's get on past this. Five things to avoid. Let me see. Evil speaking, being envious, hypocrisy, malice. Okay. The spirit in prison. Y'all, this is going to be different. Maybe I'll get to, because being in this book, I'm going to have to be dealing with the King James a lot. But you know I have to have three or four other Bibles out anyway. But I'm going to just be using this one for the commentary a little bit and the breakdown in these articles. Because they seem to be excellent, at least a different understanding. But when you do commentary, you always got to remember those are man words, right? And his interpretation of what the Bible is saying is not God's word. So you don't never just rely totally on the commentary. You stick to the scriptures and what the scripture said. This is just trying to give you a better understanding on what the Holy Spirit gave this particular man, which is Perry Stone. But commentary is not to replace the word of God ever. Let's be clear. It might give you a little bit more depth or insight, have you look at something that you might not have looked at it before, but you always read the scripture for yourself and what does the Holy Spirit give you, and then you can compare it down here if you got the same thing or not. But you always focus on the word of God. Always go with the word of God, because this is just all man's thoughts. This is not biblical. The word, the scripture is biblical. Always focus on the scripture and then just jump down here for a better understanding and or let the Holy, because you may not even agree with what he talking about. The Holy Spirit may give you something totally different. You go off what the Holy Spirit gave you. Don't go off of what they got. Go off what the Holy Spirit dropped in your spirit, because it may conflict, because the Holy Spirit speaks the truth. Amen. Anyway, I just thought I'd throw that out there because that's very important. People read the commentary more than they read the biblical text. It's just, that's a no-no. That's not what you do. Okay, it's good to have as a tool and to dig a little bit deeper and get some insight, but you never replace commentary over the word of God, ever. That's a no-no. That's rule number one, okay? You just use the commentary as a tool and dig a little bit deeper for insight, but you never replace it for the word of God, ever. Articles is good. Just, you know, entertainment, reading, you know, different perspective. You might not have thought it like that, but you always follow the text. Always follow the text, the scripture, the scripture, the scripture. Commentary is cool, but it's not the word of God. So let's not get it twisted. Amen. Revelations. I'm about to end this. Okay. The cosmic connection into the seven stars ritual. Here goes some more. The rebukes and condemnations to the seven churches. Okay. I remember going over this in the spiritual warfare book. Check that out. Okay. I have never read the book of Revelations, just the scripture here and there, but I'll I'm gonna get to it this year because I'm reading the book in chronological order. So it's so interesting. Matter of fact, I need to do my reading after I get off of here, because I have not done it today. All right, so here, yeah, this is it, y'all. This is it, y'all. This is it, y'all. Okay, the link between Islam and the end time prophecy. Interesting. The beast is the Antichrist and his kingdom. Okay, so this is just some interesting breakdowns and articles that I'm gonna dig into a little deeper. So once I get into this and I find something very interesting, y'all know I'm gonna bring it to you. So this is just basically, my channel is just a documentation of my journey, okay? And I'm just hoping you get inspired and engaged to read the word of God and learn for yourself. Study to show yourself approved, right? I just want to come on here with tips and tricks that I do to keep you engaged and keep me accountable to stay on top of what I need to stay on top of. But yeah, this is pretty much, oh, here go the maps. Okay, because there was no maps in the New Testament. So you do get some maps. All right. And they're not on the shiny paper, but it's still that kind of cardstock. But I appreciate the shine not being there. Hallelujah. But it is cardstocky. Yep, I said it. I don't know if that's a word, but I always say cardstocky. That's my word, okay? Y'all can use it. Cardstocky. That's the word. That's the word of the day. Stocky. The kingdom of Israel and Judah. This is some nice maps, though. And I'm not really a map type of girl yet. I haven't really got into all this yet. I mean, it helps. But I'm not really there yet, y'all. I'm still in the basics. I'm still trying to learn the commands and the what I should do and what I should not do. So, yeah, here it is again. This is the Perry Stone New Testament. Hebraic. Prophetic Study Bible. All right, y'all know I'm not good with pronouncing words, so forgive me again. So I hope you enjoyed this. Give it a like, a share, a thumbs up, or whatever you do. Like, share, and subscribe. Amen. Stick around. We got more content to come. God bless you. Pray for me as I pray for you. Move with purpose in your walk with Christ. Make it intentional. Amen. Because that's what we do over here. God bless. And bye-bye.